we frequently hear the private detective described as a man with a code, you know.
Right.
And in fact, one writer I know, he has the character having a conversation with his a girlfriend, and she says, "Oh yes, that would be a violation of your code, wouldn't it?" And the two of them are talking, sitting around talking about his code, which struck me as curious at the time. But you know, if Scudder ever had a code, he's long since lost the code book, you know. And I don't know many people with a code. I think the most interesting people are ones who have to figure out what to do when confronted by a situation. So Scudder always has to work that out. And I find the decisions he has to make and how he deals with them interesting. I find that one of the interesting aspects of writing the books.
Which probably keeps you interested in continuing with it.
That's right. That's right.
I've always remembered, and I don't remember which book, unfortunately, but there's a scene where he's engaged in a phone booth in some sort of, I'm just blanking out on this, but I remember there was he was either overlooking a crime or doing something of the sort, reporting it, and he's on the phone, and there's this whole thing going through his mind while he's talking on the phone. I'm sorry I can't be more articulate about which book it was, but I remember when I read it, I thought, how wonderful, you know, that you've got these two conversations going, the one he's having mm-hmm. on the phone and the one he's having with himself, mm-hmm. you know, in his head while he's talking, mm-hmm. which I think probably, you know, all of us do from time to time, have to have this sort of internal monologue. Mm-hmm. And he also has an interesting relationship with the lady in his life. She's a former... Well, in fact, when they meet, is she not actually a working prostitute? Well,
yes, until fairly late in the game. That was interesting, too, because they have a long backstory together. Before the first book, they had been important in each other's lives back when he was a cop. And then she's occasionally present, Elaine, her name is, in the early books in the series. And in about the eighth book, I think it was, A Ticket to the Boneyard, they're back, brought back together by a fellow out of their common past. And by the end of the book, writing it, I realized that I liked the evolving relationship of those two so much that it was going to continue in other books, and it has, and I've found that interesting to write.
I found her an
increasingly interesting character.
I think she is too. Hadn't he had some sort of other romance that hadn't worked out when Elaine came back into his life? Don't I remember?
Yeah.
He goes back to call on, in fact, doesn't one of the books start where the woman he was involved with calls him in?
Yes, she's ill. That came about in an interesting way, or at least I got the germ of that in an interesting way. I was at a signing one time, and a woman came up to me and said, furious, she said, "What did you do to Jan?" You know, and I looked up, and I didn't know what the hell she was talking about. And she explained that she meant Jan Keane, who had been his sweetheart in A Stab in the Dark, and had been so helpful to him in Early Sobriety and 8 Million Ways to Die, and all of a sudden she's out of the picture and he's with Elaine, and what happened to Jan, you know? And I said, well, things just didn't work out. And she really gave me hell about this. And I was thinking about that afterward, and what I found myself thinking about was the continuing relationship between people who were intimate, who were lovers, who aren't anymore, the affair is over, but they still have certain emotional claims on each other. And I found that interesting, and then the idea occurred of Jen's getting in touch because she's terminally ill and she wants him to provide the means for a final exit for her should she choose to take it. And that was... That was interesting to write.
Which book was that?
That was The Devil Knows You're Dead.
That was a very powerful scene. I remember reading it because I had a scare myself with what was thought to be terminal breast cancer, which, as it happened, I didn't have. But mm-hmm. I remember thinking about Jan and remembering some mm-hmm. emotions I myself had had. Mm-hmm. It was a terrific. And you're right. I think people don't just always make final emotional exits. They do come back and forth, mm-hmm. especially when they all live in... a particular place, and all of your Scudder books take place in Manhattan, don't they?
Yeah, they're all in New York.
Mm-hmm. It's been said that your breakout book was When the Sacred Gin Mill Closes.
Well, it wasn't commercially. I don't think it did such a much in sales, so I don't know. When the Sacred Gin Mill Closes certainly is the favorite book of a lot of readers. I think probably more than any other single book, they tend to like that one.
Why so, do you think?
I think it's probably... There's a term illustrators have. They'll describe something as painterly. And if you had a similar word, like writerly, I think it may be a more writerly book, maybe more a novel of character and mood than the others. I'm not sure, but one way or another, it does seem to work for a lot of people.
Interesting, then, that Dance at the Slaughterhouse was the one that won the Edgar Award.
Well, you know, awards are a committee likes that year, and they're hard to figure. My feeling is that if you just keep at it long enough, you'll wind up with a lot of hardware to hang on the wall.
Interesting thought.
Yeah.
Your current book, in fact, the one you've come to sign for us, is Everybody Dies?
Yes.
And that is, trying to remember, is that the 10th?
No, 14th.
14th, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What can you tell us a little bit about it?
Sure. It's people have asked, everyone likes the title Everybody Dies, but people have asked whether it's philosophical or descriptive in this instance. And one can say that it's probably a little of both. And in the book, Matt has arrived at a point of equilibrium in his life. He's now no longer living in that hotel room that he occupied since the first book, but moved across the street. He's living with Elaine across the street. He's even given up the room. He's married, which everyone, the conventional wisdom, of course, is that a detective hero, certainly a hard-boiled detective hero, can't be married or people won't find him interesting anymore. That turns out, I'm happy to report, not to be the case. And he's even got a PI's license for the first time. He'd never even applied for one before, mm-hmm. but he'd been doing so much work for attorneys, and several have pointed out that they could use him more if he was licensed, because there are certain things where that's of value. So he even has that, and he's feeling reasonably respectable. And then things happen that let him know that the world is not a safe place, and that he's not as respectable as settled as he thought. He undertakes an investigation for his friend Mick Ballou, who has had a couple of employees murdered by persons unknown, and who wants to know whether the crime was simply a commercial venture or whether he's got an enemy.
Mm-hmm.
And in the course of this, a lot of things happen that we won't get into yet, and he finds himself in the middle of a war.
Is this the one? I noticed there was a little quote on the bottom of USA Today from the book, and I'm gathering that he gets to be part of a body disposal unit.
That's how the book starts.
They've got a body in the trunk of a car, and they're off. And I thought it certainly does argue that he's back on the edge and out of his safe place if he's off into burying a corpse.
Yeah.
So maybe he just needed to be shaken up?
And it's a book with a high body count, I must say. I don't know whether... It just felt like the book to write. It's been one that I've had in mind for about 4 years now. It takes a while for the elements to coalesce.